So we move on to the next topic of the syllabus, and that is antiviral agents and antiretroviral agents. A very apt topic in this scenario when we have been attacked by a virus and we are suffering through a pandemic for the past more than a year now. Okay, so this virus, this organism, there is a lot of controversy whether it should be called a living organism itself or no. The primary reason being that when it is outside the host body or it is on inanimate objects, which means non-living things, table, chair, all these kinds of things, it is not able to survive, or it is, in a way, it is dead. But the moment it enters the host cell, the host body, it starts surviving, it starts living. Okay, so that is why there has always been a controversy whether this virus, this microorganism, should be called as a living organism also or no. So this small microorganism, which you are not able to see with naked eye and you need a specialized microscope or an electron microscope, is a very infectious agent, and you can say that it is not new to the human race. We have been having viral infections for ages together. Okay, we have had the Spanish flu epidemic, which was similar to the COVID-19 epidemic that we are suffering through now. And it proved as a challenge because in spite of the fact that we had antibiotics, we were not able to use these antibiotics for the treatment of viral infections. Now, these viral cells, or these virions as they are also called, they can be of different shapes. You can have a rod shape, you can have a filament shape, spherical shape, rectangular, triangular, tubular. You can have several shapes for this virion or this virus. And these virions or these virus, they will start proliferating, or they will start reproducing as soon as they are inside the human body, or inside any living body for that matter. Now, in Greek language, in Latin language itself, the word virion means poisonous. So that is the reason probably we see the terror that COVID-19 has been causing on our lives, that it is highly poisonous or it is extremely poisonous. Now, if you decide to tell that how does this infection spread, or how do viral infections spread? Like we saw, Entamoeba histolytica, it needs a vector, or the malarial parasite needs a vector. So how does this viral infection spread? There are two ways or two mechanisms by which a viral infection can spread. One is what is called as the vertical spreading. Okay, and by vertical spreading, we mean that from the mother, it can go to the child. You are aware that HIV can be transmitted from the mother to the child or to the fetus. Okay, whereas other viral diseases or other virions, many of them in fact, they spread through horizontal transmission. The best example could be COVID-19. So they are using human body fluids for the spreading of the virus. So by this, I mean from person to person, this viral infection can spread. So other than having been known Spanish flu, there are many others. The common cold that we all usually get once there is a seasonal change is a viral infection. Influenza is a viral infection. The deadly hepatitis B and C, they both are viral infections. Chickenpox and smallpox, something that probably your generation has never suffered from, is also a viral infection. Herpes, okay, or what is called as nagin in Hindi, it is also a viral infection. So these are the different viral infections that are known to the human, And polio is a viral infection. So these viral infections, we have been knowing them from ages together, and we have successfully combated them, successfully controlled them, and we have given a fight against all these viral infections. Now, the best way to fight a viral disease definitely is a vaccine, okay? Even more than having a drug, it is better to have a vaccine. It is a cheap way, it is an effective way of preventing the spread of the infection across the population of people. And the resistance that a vaccine could give you because of taking it is widespread, and it stays for a longer period of time, unlike using a antiviral drug where you would get temporary relief and then probably you would be back to getting a new viral infection. So that is the reason so much of efforts have been put in finding a vaccine for COVID-19 rather than finding a drug. Of course, we did find some drugs, but our insistence has been on finding a vaccine for the treatment of any viral infection. So we have with us several viral vaccines. Like, we have chickenpox, smallpox, we have MMR, we have polio vaccine, poliomyelitis vaccine. In fact, poliomyelitis vaccine, we have it in both forms, as an injectable and as an oral drops also. You must be aware that the Government of India every year in the months of January and February does a nationwide drive for controlling polio disease or polio virus by inoculating children under the age of 5 with this polio drops. Before that, the children also have received the poliomyelitis injection vaccine as well. In fact, there are 2 to 3 doses of the injection of polio vaccine. However, till the age of 5, as a precautionary measure, as and when possible, polio drops are administered to kids. Now, there could be different ways in which a virus could spread from one person to another, okay? Yes, routes of viral entry. It could be an inoculated, it could be inhaled, like what is happening with us just now, sexually transmitted like HIV. It could be vertical or congenital, like I told you, from the mother to the fetus through blood. Again, one of the ways in which HIV is spreading by ingestion as well. That is, it is like a biological tool or a biological weapon that somebody injects it into the body. So these are the different routes of viral entry into the human body. And the ways in which the virus, which is present in our body, it could be excreted out through coughing through droplets, aerosol droplets. Then, of course, in the blood, the virus will be present in body fluids, right from the spinal fluid to the semen will contain the virus. And that is exactly how HIV spreads, or even through the fecal matter. Now, this is exactly the reason why polio was taken up as a drive for eradicating poliomyelitis disease or poliomyelitis virus. The spread of the virus polio is very vast. It spreads very easily. And the major reasons that we are doing it, because our neighboring countries, including Pakistan, Bangladesh, they do not have such polio drives. And through fecal matter, the fecal matter can enter the water. We share borders, we share water resources with both these countries. And there is always a fear that this way, the poliomyelitis virus can re-enter our country. A few years back, around some 6 years back, we declared India completely polio free. India was successful in eradicating the virus polio. However, we still do the polio drive. Similarly, chicken pox, small pox, these are also diseases which are caused by a virus. We still have vaccination even for the fact that we have in a way eradicated cowpox, smallpox and chickenpox. There are very rare cases now that you would see an individual suffering from chickenpox or smallpox. And even if the person suffers from chickenpox or smallpox, the intensity of the infection would not be very severe. Like we are saying in the case of COVID-19, having done vaccination, either one or both the doses, your chances of requiring hospitalization and an ICU would decrease dramatically because you have had a vaccine. Of course, the fear remains that there are a lot of variants coming in. But right now, we can surely say that whatever variants have come in for all the vaccines that have been produced till date, we have been easily able to combat those variants also. So this virus or this virion has a very typical and a very beautiful structure. This is how your viral structure looks. Very much similar to what we have been seeing on the media about the coronavirus as well, okay, or the COVID-19 virus as well. So this viral structure contains of different parts. The main part, of course, what you see over here in blue color is the DNA or RNA matter. Now, depending upon whether inside over here there is DNA or RNA, you classify the virus as a RNA virus or a DNA virus. So if you have RNA, this blue part which is there over here, if this is a RNA, then it is a RNA virus. If it is a DNA, then it is a DNA virus. Okay. And then there are other layers which this RNA or DNA is enclosed of the virus. So there is a capsid or an envelope. Okay. Then there is a lipid bilayer membrane. So this is the capsid which is surrounding the nucleus. So it is called as the nuclear capsid. Then there is a core or a envelope which is present around, and these are the spikes on the core or on the envelope around the nucleus. And it is these spikes which are present that are actually responsible for protruding into the host and attaching to the receptors. So again, we would take the COVID-19 example. It is these spikes on the coronavirus which are responsible for binding of the virus to our lung cells or to the receptors in the lung and then spreading. So once the virus is able to bind onto a cell, whether a human cell or animal cell is not important, to any living cell, once it is able to bind it, it will start replicating. Till it is on an inanimate object, it is as good as in a dead state. Okay. But as soon as it binds to a living cell, it starts replicating immediately. And how does the replication begin? The RNA or the DNA of the virus becomes a part of the human cell or the animal cell or the living cell in general. And as the human cell multiplies or as the animal cell multiplies, the virus also multiplies. So this is how the infection spreads in the body. So now there are different types. Like I told you, there are different shapes of viruses. So there are helical viruses. There are hedral or iscohedral viruses. The hepatitis B is an iscohedral virus. There is an enveloped virus. There is sometimes a non-enveloped virus also. And overall, the structure of virus is very complicated. So these are the structural features of the virus structure, which I have explained just now. Then I told you that the virus can be classified as an RNA virus, which is called as a retrovirus, which mainly contains RNA. Okay. And the multiplication will take place backwards. I will come to this. these are some of the examples of retrovirus. The polio is a retrovirus. Pneumonia, measles, mumps, rubella is a retrovirus. COVID-19 is a retrovirus. Then there is a DNA virus, where the center of the viral structure is DNA. These are some of the examples. Hepatitis A, B, C, the smallpox and chickenpox virus. These are all the examples of DNA virus. Okay, now we'll come to this part where we say that there is a reverse multiplication. If you are aware in the subject of biotechnology, or when you are studying the multiplication or the formation of RNA and protein, the sequence is such that there is DNA in the cell, in the living cell, and this DNA forms what is called as a RNA. In fact, it is a mRNA. Okay, then this mRNA gives rise to proteins, and then the cell which is infected bursts open, and the proteins spread the infection to the different parts of the body. So this is the sequence. There is DNA, then there is RNA, then there is the protein formation. However, in the case of a retrovirus, or in the case of an what is called as an RNA virus, you already have RNA with you. Okay, but for the protein formation, this RNA is not sufficient. The RNA, which is the core, which is forming the core of the retrovirus, this cannot directly give you proteins. So there is a reverse process which is happening, which means that there is RNA. This RNA forms DNA. Then this DNA forms RNA again. And then this second type of RNA, which has been formed, that will form the proteins. Okay. So when this multiplication is happening, or this formation of DNA or RNA is happening, the DNA double helical structure breaks open, and each strand of the DNA will give you another strand of the RNA. Okay. So if there is a, there, or there will be a sequence, the ATCG. Okay. Then for A, there will be T. For C, there will be G. For G, there will be C. For T, there will be A. So this way, all the nucleosides and nucleotides will be substituted. The purines and pyrimidines of the DNA will multiply, and a new strand is formed. Now, once this new strand is formed, the DNA has formed RNA. Now, this RNA, which has formed, is going to form proteins by releasing a sequence of amino acids. This is the normal pathway. Okay, this happens in human beings also. This practically happens in every living cell which contains DNA as its matter. Now, in the case of RNA virus, what is going to happen is there is RNA. That RNA is also going to have a strand. To that strand, a new structure or a new strand will be generated. Okay. Now, this strand and the previous RNA strand will come together to actually form the DNA. Then this DNA double helical structure will again separate, and it will give rise to the mRNA. Then mRNA will give you proteins. So instead of eating food straight, it is eating food in a complicated manner. This is exactly the reason why it is more difficult to treat retroviral infections than it is to treat a viral infection which is containing DNA as its matter. Okay, so this is about the DNA virus and RNA virus. So once the virus comes in contact with the host cell, it attaches itself to the host cell with the help of those spikes which are present on all over its structure. Okay, and once it attaches itself, it slowly penetrates into the host cell. So here at stage two, it has come into the host cell, and whatever layer it was covered with, okay, there was a capsid, and it was called as a nucleocapsid. All those layers, they break open, all of them get removed, the virus gets uncoated, and this virus enters into the host cell nucleus. Now, once it enters the host cell nucleus, it takes control of the DNA as well as the RNA of the host cell and as well as the protein production of the host cell. So here inside the host cell, it will become a part of the host cell DNA, and when the host cell DNA will multiply to form the mRNA, the mRNA that is formed is a defective mRNA. It is not the normal mRNA of the human being. It is a defective mRNA which constitutes of the part from the virus as well as the part from the human cell. Okay. Now, once this defective mRNA in the cell has been formed, the proteins which are going to get generated from here are going to also be defective proteins or proteins which are going to spread the infection. Okay, so you see over here, there is opening or uncoating of the virus. It has come into in contact with the host cell DNA. Here, after forming, getting formed into the host cell DNA or becoming a part of the host cell DNA, it is forming ribosomes and mRNA. And this mRNA or this defective mRNA is forming these virions. Okay. And these virions will now break open the cell membrane of the human cell and it will go and spread to the different parts of the body. So the infection, which probably begins in the nasal region, travels through the trachea into the lungs. In the lungs, the receptors are present and these receptors bind. And once they bind, they start capturing the human cells. And after capturing the human cells, they release these virions. These virions burst open the cells and they start capturing the neighboring lung cells. So this way, slowly, I am quoting the example here of COVID-19 because I'm taking the lung cell example. So slowly the entire lung gets infected. So, in this same manner, when you are suffering from hepatitis, the liver cells get infected, hepatitis B and C. Or if you are suffering from herpes, okay, varicella zoster is the virus which is causing the herpes infection. And this herpes, or like I told you, it is called as nagin in Hindi. It can happen to in any part of the body. Usually you will see that the herpes zoster virus or the varicella zoster virus infection happens at the waistline of a person. Okay. So at the waistline, you will see that it has captured one part of the cells near the waistline. As the virus multiplies on the skin or on the human cells, the infection is spreading. Okay. And you will see that there is growth in the infection. Like you see the fungal infection spreads, the viral infection is also visible when it is spreading in the case of varicella zoster virus. So this infection or these viral infections are known to be attacking people who are having a low immune system. We have been hearing so much about building up of the immune system in us presently. This is exactly the reason why so much of insistence is being given. Okay, so we have already seen these steps: adsorption or attachment, penetration. After penetration, there is the unenveloped virus is released, and then this virus is forming a part of the human cell or the human DNA. And when the multiplication is happening, the infected DNA is also replicating. Okay, uncoating, transcription, that is synthesis of mRNA. That is what it is called. Conversion of DNA to mRNA is called as transcription. And then translation, which means the viral mRNA is translated to ribosomes and to form structural and non-structural proteins. Okay. And then finally, structural and non-structural proteins of the virus are released from the cell to move on to other cells so that they can also get infected. Yes, so I have already told you this, that you have the RNA virus, the reverse transcriptase virus, which enters the host cell. In the host cell, it forms a part of the DNA of the host cell. Then there is reverse transcriptase. Now, why it is called as reverse transcriptase is, transcription is a process in which mRNA is synthesized from DNA, okay? Whereas reverse transcription is a process in which you already have RNA and it is forming DNA. So it is opposite of transcription. That is why it is called as reverse transcription, okay? So reverse transcription happens from the RNA of the virus, the DNA is formed, then this DNA forms it undergoes transcription, then it undergoes translation. That means first the mRNA will be formed, then from the mRNA, the retroviral proteins will be released and these will spread the infection further, okay? And I have quoted some examples over here. Human T cell leukemia and human immunodeficiency virus. These are some of the examples, okay? Yes, so I told you that the virus can be inside the host cell and it can occur and it can stay in two ways. One is what is called as a lytic infection and the other is a lysogenic infection. So in the lytic infection, the host cell is invaded by the virus. The virus is active and the spread of the infection starts. So there is an active infection that is happening in the case of this, of these lytic infections. Okay. Now, the other type of infection is the lysogenic infection. In lysogenic infections, what is seen is the immune system of the person is very strong, is very strong, and the person has the virus in it, but there is no infection. So what is going to happen is he is just going to be a carrier. So if I am having a lysogenic infection, I am a carrier and I will be infecting everybody. Okay. So these are the two different types of infections, lytic infections and lysogenic infections that can happen in viral infections. We have already seen these routes of viral entry.